So, hi everyone, my name is Alexia Chebrunet. I'm a journalist and climber from Montreal here in Canada, and I'm here tonight with the Arc'teryx Climbing Academy to present you one of the great climbing stories of Canada. So I'm really excited and grateful to have with me Julien Bourassa-Moreau, which is an all-around climber from Quebec. We've done everything from high-level competition to incredible hard trad first ascents. So his achievements here really inspire a bunch of people in Eastern Canada. So I'm really glad to have you here. Welcome, Julien.
Thank you. Thank you, Alexis.
So
I'm happy to be here too.
Yeah, great. So we're both glad with this. Just as a disclaimer, we're both French Canadians doing this interview in English. So if we make any mistakes, it's part of the whole experience. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to start this discussion a little bit by asking you about the very start of your climbing career, because I personally don't really know about it that much. So I wanted to know, how exactly did you get into this world, and at what point did you realize it would become such a huge part of your life?
So how did I discover rock climbing?
Yeah, well, climbing in general as a whole.
Yeah, so I started climbing when I was like a teenager. Uh-huh. And I have, we're like five brothers in my family. And one of my brother was like doing, like in high school, he was like in a rock band, and he was like doing a show in this neighborhood in Montreal, like the Southwest, and in this bar. And my parents came to the show, and obviously they came like way too early. Mm-hmm. So they went like to, and they got in the neighborhood, and they're like walking around the neighborhood, and it starts like raining. So they're like, they like find like shelter in a place, and they end up like finding shelter in the old alley, like this like old brick building in this neighborhood. And they get in, and it's like, they like ask a few questions and stuff, and then it keeps like raining outside. So they keep like asking questions and to like look interested so they can stay inside like while it rains.
Yeah, it's really like a fairy tale story where they went in and...
Yeah, and then they came out of the gym or something, and then they told me and my brother about it, my older brother. Uh-huh. And they're like, oh, you should really try it and stuff. And then me and my brother, like we showed up to the gym, and we're like late for the intro to like top rope belay class. Mm-hmm. And none of us are like 18 year old, like I'm like 14 and he's like 17, and they still like would let us in somehow without a signature of anyone who's like major and stuff. And just like, we just ended up like doing our intro to belay class, and we just like dived into this world that was like, I think for me, it was a great way to like put like the energy I had as a teenager into something, into like this one passion that was.
Yeah. And did it back become then, a passion right away, or it took a little time for you to really dig into
it? It took very little time for me to dig into it. And it was like such like a nice, like back then, like climbing was much smaller. And like, mm-hmm. everyone, like when you would get in the gym, you would like basically like say hello to like everyone like on the lead climbing wall, because you knew like everyone by name. And it was like a really great community to fall into. Yeah, as a
And when did you start competing for a team or?
Like back then, like climbing was really like this thing that we would do with the goal of like climbing outside. Like, mm-hmm. we were still like, I started in a climbing gym, but like every weekend, like very early on, like every weekend we would go to like Romney or go to like Val-David or like other
with
places.
With your parents? They were into it as well, or?
No, my parents are not climbers, but like just with like people at the gym, and yeah. that would like take us to the crag and stuff. Mm-hmm. But in the winter we would like obviously like it's like very cold and snowy, and you can't climb in Eastern Quebec, like, or in Eastern Canada. So we ended up like doing comps, but really like as a winter thing. And it yeah. was like kind of like the seasonal thing, that in the winter you do comps and in the summer you climb outside. And then after that, like So I did a little bit of competition at that point, but after that, I mostly climbed outside, I guess.
Yeah, because when I first met you personally, I was working at Block Shop and you were competing for Team Block Shop at the time. You competed at an elite level for a long period of time, winning Tour de Bloc and even attending multiple IFSC World Cups. How would you consider that this time define your climbing, and how did your outlook on the sport change since then?
I think like after like many years of climbing, mm-hmm. I was studying at the time, and I would like usually like take like all the time I had off of school mm-hmm. To go. First, I would go like to the West Coast and like climb in Squamish and like work maybe like roofing or picking cherries and stuff, mm-hmm. and then at some point I just like started just like traveling in Europe and in the summer, and then in the winter maybe I'll be able to like go on a like shorter escape to like Europe or to like the south of the States, and then at some point I just spent like more and more time with school, like mm-hmm. Studying pharmacy, and then mm-hmm. like becoming a pharmacist, and through my first like throughout like the first year of my career as a pharmacist, I had like less time to travel, mm-hmm. and the competitions just like it just came back into my life in a very organic way, like just like naturally I would like go on climbing competitions and stuff, and I would like I ended up like doing well, and it mm-hmm. was like very motivating to like pursue this. And then
would you define you as a natural was it easy for you to perform well quite early, or you had to work for it?
I think I was I don't know, like, you know, the grades at Alley-Up were pretty stiff back then. So it took me a while to do like my first 5.8, my first 5.9, mm-hmm. my first 5.10.
But you climbed 5.14 quite young, if I'm correct.
Yeah, I did it like pretty fast. I think like, I don't know, like in 2-3 years, I did Cassiope.
Yes, in Baldi, in the Laurentians, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then, but I think like it's for climbing competition, like it took me like I came back like mm-hmm. years and years later to climbing competitions. And I think like something in me makes it that like I perform well when I'm under pressure. Mm-hmm. So I had like a natural fit with the competition scene, and I ended up like doing like very well, at least to me. Like I really felt like I had like these like amazing moments like in the Canadian scene of a competition. And I don't know exactly why, because like some of these moments just feel like magical to me. They all clicked together, but it's like part of the beauty of climbing is like just like you go into this like very chaotic sport where like you have to take risks, and you have to like there's a part of it that's just like random, but you just like somehow like sneak your way through like randomness and like
do you think that
when things go well, yeah,
that your competing background helped you in what you're doing now, like discovering new routes and try out some old aid routes and try to free climb them? Do you think that like competing worked like your mind to really dig in into finding a sequence and
yeah, definitely. Yeah, like in multiple ways. I think the style of competition that I did the most is like bouldering comps. Mm-hmm. And bouldering comps, you have the usual format, you have like 5 minutes to solve a problem, mm-hmm. and a lot of the time you have to do it flash, like if you want to like do well in a round or like win a round, or if you want a spot on the podium, you have to do it flash. And there's a lot of it that it's like actually really similar to like on-site climbing, mm-hmm. where you have like limited information and you have to solve something very quickly. Or just also like if you fall and you try it again, it's like very helpful for like red pointing as well, where you have to like find a sequence quickly and stuff. And also I think another thing that helps a lot is that when you compete, like I competed quite a lot. I did like 3 years mm-hmm. of of competing, where I would progressively like spend more and more energy into this discipline of climbing. And yes. You learn to be an athlete, which is something that like most other climbers, they're like kind of lazy, and somehow they have like this idea that you shouldn't train or you shouldn't warm up.
Yeah, it's not part of the ethic when you're climbing outside, really.
But like you still have, like even when you climb outside, like you still have to like perform on a given moment. Like now, like is the time mm-hmm. that conditions are right. Now is the time that you're in front of the route and you have to perform now. And this is something that you learn when you compete, is like you have to perform now. Like you don't decide if you're going 5 minutes later or not. Like this is
this is your time and you have to perform at this particular time.
So you learn to like not be a lazy, like a flaky climber, and you just learn to be like on point and like be ready and like perform on demand or something.
I was wondering, was there a moment when you decided that you would stop competing or like shift your focus from bouldering competitions to just climbing outside?
I think like, to be honest, like doing the World Cup circuit was like, I had a lot of fun in the Canadian competitions. But the World Cup, like it was like maybe like too hard for me, and I didn't felt like that I was like really like part of that, that group or part of that community. And I just felt like I was kind of like out of place. And it came naturally at a moment where in my professional career, like I could do what I'm doing now, which is like taking like a lot of time off and travel, like have like long travels and be like more nomadic. So it was like kind of a very natural switch to just like stop competing. And also like, I think it's like very common also for like competition climbers that you're not gonna do this like all your life. Mm-hmm. And I did like—
And at some point you have to shift to something else.
Mm-hmm. And I don't think I can do any better than what I have done. And mm-hmm. I really feel like I've like dug into like all the corners that I wanted to dug into that thing. And now, like it felt
and
like
now,
a very
like
natural.
Basically, living a nomadic life between like your career as a pharmacist and like spending the rest of the year traveling and like working the routes themselves. So, like, do you find it hard to balance work and play sometimes? Like, how does it work? Like living like this.
I for me at least, like, I really enjoy having something that has nothing to do with climbing in my mm-hmm. life, where like, because climbing is like useless, you know, like you get on top of a rock and at the end of the day, like the rock stays the same, you stay the same. Like if you succeed, your ego is like swollen a little bit. And if you fail, your ego is scratched. Like, this is what is happening in climbing. So like, it's nice to have something to balance this, where like I'm a healthcare professional. So what I do is like, very useful. Mm-hmm. Like I give like service to people that are sick and that like really need these services. So,
so you have something useful in your life and something less useful.
Yeah. But I have to say, like when I switch, there's always like this like weird moment where, like when I switch from the traveling life to the working life, there's like this moment where it's like either I'm like, it's this weird moment of like being happy from your traveling and then coming back to like a more like more square lifestyle.
Yeah.
Have to fit in a box. Yeah.
And how do you choose the locations where you go climbing? Is it like, do you think of a particular line that you want to do or just some places that you want to see or experiment?
I think like in the past it was easier to choose just because before the pandemic, like so I would like, I think I would choose places which are like, first of all, have where it's the right season to go to, like mm-hmm. If you have like the opportunity to go anywhere in the world, you have to go like to the place when it's in season. And then like obviously I travel for climbing, so like I'm gonna go to the best climbing destination. But then like also it's like just like the the traveling aspect of it, like discovering a new continent, like going to China or going to Australia, it's like pretty sick. Like just seeing like wild places or seeing like a different culture and then also it's like maybe like I'm gonna go to like Slovenia to like visit a friend because like I want to see him and mm-hmm. And so I guess it's like the thing that I'm psyched about, and also mm-hmm. it's like through a lot of discussion, like always talking to different people and like getting to know like what the world has to offer as a climbing destination.
Yeah, you learn about new places and you have new ideas about things you want to do.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, you said it like with COVID-19, I think last year you obviously spent more time climbing here in Quebec. Last spring, you managed to red point La Zébrée for the people who don't know it. Like La Zébrée is a 514A trad line in Val-David, so about an hour north of Montreal. And like, it's a really impressive achievement because it, like before your ascent, it hadn't been repeated for 13 years, I think.
Yeah, something like this.
Was by Pee-wee Ouellet. So I wanted to know like what the effort around the climb and like the work that you had to put into this represented to you, like
For me, like this line, like obviously, like I grew up climbing in Quebec, so like I knew about this line for like years and years, and mm-hmm. it just like represented this like kind of like holy grail of climbing in Quebec, like this like, sick looking splitter like going through a roof, and it's like a black streak and white streak coming down. And it's just like, you look at it and you're like, whoa, like this looks like vicious. Like, I really want to get my hands into that crack and see.
Yeah, it's really impressive when you see it for the first time. It really mm-hmm. like comes out of the wall and it looks at you basically.
The winter before COVID or the spring, like before COVID hit like Europe and North America, mm-hmm. I was in Europe. I was in like south of Spain. Yep. And I was in a really good shape, like climbing like a steep sport route, like very steep stuff, and on tufa mostly, or like mm-hmm. Other types of limestone climbing, and so I was in a really good shape, and also I knew like I always had this route in the back of my mind, and somehow I had the like plan of getting back on this route, and I knew like the style would be kind of similar. It's like weird to say, but like there's something like about like climbing a tufa like this, a steep tufa. It's kind of similar to like climbing a steep crack.
Yeah, into granite.
So like for the like physical aspect of it, like I was very allies or like
You were in right shape to do.
Feeling confident on like the very steep stuff, and so like the steepness of it wasn't an issue, uh-huh. but it was just like learning. The crack climbing techniques and coming out of a quarantine and lockdown where we like didn't climb much. We like just like.
Have
just
you always been a good hand jammer, or you've learned this along the way?
I've been climbing for a long time and tried climbing for a long time, but like crack climbing to a harder level, it's like more something new. But I built like a crack climbing machine, and I could like train a little bit, like the different grips, like
basement or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. But then like granite is like a lot more like it's usually like combined jams, so it's like mm-hmm. the jam will be like flare or will be weird and stuff. So I had to adapt, but I ended up like doing a lot of like other routes, like other trad routes in Quebec, like mm-hmm. just building my repertoire or like all the types of movements that you typically do on a climb like this. So for me, like this route, it was like this super fun process of like getting to know the route. The route is like always kind of wet too.
Yeah.
So like at first it's like you get annoyed by it, but then you like learn to just like
to deal with just, it and work through it.
You have to like look and see like where is the water coming from. So it's kind of like this meditative like state where you have to get up on the route first and you look, and then you dry the rock, and then you look and you see like, oh, this is where the water is coming from, and then you put a sponge like right there, and then it's like this iterative process that you do again and again, and then eventually like you kind of like built this relationship with the route where you get to like know, you have a feeling right if it's going to be dry or wet on that day. And then doing it, I ended up like having a lot of trouble with one of the cruxes, like and always like falling off of some of the finger locks.
Yeah.
But then I on this day I was belayed by Pee-wee and I could just like dig deep, and I did it like not perfectly. I did like a few mistakes, but I could just like pull through, and I had this like great climbing experience of like pushing myself and fighting and having like the cherry on top of.
It must have been special, like being belayed by the man that did the first ascent.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And I think he either like all the ascents up to me, he either like belayed the person.
Yeah, he belayed
Jeff Beaulieu, who did it like pinpoint first, and he belayed like Sly, and then he belayed me. So it was like special for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, because like, in addition to La Zébrée, you've also done like the first three ascents of La Raie in Tawachiche and
Les Tawachiche.
In Tawachiche, yes.
Yeah.
And Les Enfants Magiques, which is also in Val-David, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So those are both like hard trad lines in the 514 range, but these are mostly like old aid routes. So like, how do you approach a route that hasn't been like free climbed before? Like without even knowing if it like if it could be free climb.
I don't know. I think it's like almost easier. Like you have no expectations. Like you, it's more like you decide how you approach it. Like you approach it with a metal brush. This is what you do.
Yeah, because the one in Tawachiche like was quite like far away. It was a canoe approach and.
Yeah, it's a sick crowd. Like you get there. It's like a dirt road. It's in like a zec, like in a place which is mostly like for hunters and
fishing and
fishing and you just like there's like a short canoe approach to the crag, and it's just this amazing like dome of granite that just like you don't see it when you start canoeing, but you just like go across this like piece of land and then you just see like this thing like sticking out, and it's like usually in the sun in the morning, and it's just like so impressive, like this like golden thing of granite.
Yeah, it's pretty tall. Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty tall. It's pretty big. There's a lot of potential. There's like it's only like the best, maybe like some of the best routes have been done, but like there's still like a lot of like really good, and even some of the best like splitter climbs are still like unclimbed. Mm. And La Raie was like so striking. The first time I went to this crag, I was like, oh my god, like what is this line? And I didn't even know what it was, but I was like, I really want to like get my hands on this. It's just like this perfect like head wall. So there's like a first like maybe 5.9 like 5.9 minus pitch to like, or 5.10 minus pitch to like approach, and it's just like this perfect like slightly overhanging wall with like a splitter that ends, and then just like another splitter that starts like just where the splitter end.
Yeah.
Like, just see it from the ground.
It just seems so natural, like to fall.
Yeah. So it's like an amazing line, and it was also like the perfect difficulty for me. Like, and like these routes, like, I guess like you, these like very hard, like gear routes or trad routes, you just like, we went like with a brush, and I did a lot of brushing, and I tried a sequence, and I had a sequence that like was extreme, and then we ended up like finding another sequence which was like a little bit easier, and then you work out the gear, and then you do your first rise on lead, and then it's like kind of scary.
Yeah, and it's a whole process like with like steps that you have to get through to the final goal.
And then you like learn the route, and then you learn like you try to trim your rack so you don't carry so much weight, so you get really scared because you don't place a lot of gear, and then it's like just like this super fun, like there's the fear aspect. Even if this route is safe, there's still like something like exciting about like getting on the route. Like,
yeah, so on that topic, like, what would you say to the people who still doubt the climbing potential in Quebec and Eastern Canada, because sometimes when you look at the West, it's obvious that you have lots of stuff to climb there. But like,
I don't know much about Ontario, but I think they're like the poor people of poor rock climbing in the Eastern Canada. But Quebec has a lot of potential. I think like I've traveled a lot, so I've seen like some amazing rock, and I've seen like amazing places with like a lot of rock, and but Quebec still has like a lot of like really nice gems. Like it's much like smaller, but like the thing is like it's cold. Like the winter is pretty long, and then spring is short, and then summer is like hot and humid and full of mosquitoes and flies and nauseam and like all the things that like will draw blood on you. And if you go there like in August, September,
October. Yeah, in the fall and the spring, I think those are the best moments to climb in Quebec.
Yeah, and I think there's going to be like a lot of like if people keep putting the effort, there's going to be a lot of like nice climbing areas.
But yeah, new areas. And like as you know, I currently live in Rimouski in Eastern Quebec, and just around this region, like there are plenty of new areas and new routes that are being opened all the time, because like people get into climbing right now. So like, of course, it'll grow more attention, and and like the will to develop new areas.
Yeah. Yeah. I think there's a culture of route development that's like starting to build in Quebec, which is pretty good.
And with the increase in popularity of like bouldering and in like even bouldering, which is like climbing artificial structures and in cities, infrastructures or whatever, and like you've put up like the now famous V12 line under the Rosemont Viaduct in Montreal. Yeah. Like, what do you think like this type of climbing is gonna influence like the whole spectrum, like in the end? What are your perspective on the future of climbing as a sport?
I don't know, like I've done like I did a lot of bouldering like years and years ago, where I would go, like we would go quite a lot, like just like hunt for lines and climb lines, and every time like people would say like he's only doing this because he can't go to the real rock and stuff. I was mad. I couldn't when people would say this, because I was like, dude, like, look at the lines we're climbing. Like, this is like even better. Like, it's like sick lines. Like, you don't find this on rock. Like, it's like, and the fact, like, what really interested me is that it's kind of the same thing. Like, you climb a structure that wasn't meant to be climbed at first. Yeah. Like, when you climb a piece of rock, nature didn't say like, oh, you're going to need a pocket here and a crimper there, and this is why
it's there. Yeah, you have to find the, like...
it's just like humans, like we find this interpretation for the rock, and if you climb an artificial structure that's just been built to be a bridge, but it's still like a sick climbing line, it's like, it feels so great. And it feels like kind of like, it's the same like magic of like finding a nice boulder outside or something. So we ended up like, like bouldering quite a lot, like finding cool lines, like, yeah. And we wouldn't be looking for like just like stone walls, which are like similar to climbing outside. We were looking for like concrete, because in Montreal, there's like a lot of concrete with the Olympics, like back in the days, they built everything out of concrete. And it makes like these very unique lines that have like very interesting climbing movements. And then we found like the VVH, the Viaduct Van Arn, and I ended up like working it for 3 years. Like I had like the small wall I had in the basement at my parents' house was like kind of a, for some reason it was like the same type of feature, so it was kind of a replica of it. So
people are still working the line as today. Like I saw a video recently, like there's a lot of attention around it right now.
Yeah, do it before it gets before they destroy the overpass.
We don't have like much time left, and that's a shame, because I think we could talk about stuff for hours. But finally, I was wondering if you have like any updates on like where you're heading next, or what are you focusing on right now?
So right now, like, I don't know, like, climbing has always been this like growing thing for me, where it's just like exploring. Like, I was always like interested into doing the thing that I was the most like, I don't know, excited to do, and now, like, a new way I found to grow is like just like climbing a lot in North America, doing a lot of trad long routes, and it's just like always looking for and also I've been climbing for so long that like
you have to renew the motivation.
Yeah, and like I've, you know, like sometimes you want to perform on something, and I had so many like moments where I wanted to perform and was like either disappointed by my performance and stuff, that like now I feel like I've, like, for the last few years I have like a, I feel like I have a nice like like a relationship with climbing, where I'm really more interested to just like do cool stuff and do stuff that I'm excited about. And now it's like climbing trad, climbing long routes, and climbing with like the good partner to do the stuff. Like, I'm more interested to like find a good partner to do something that I think is like sick.
Then a good partner and a line that inspires you, and it's all that you need.
Yeah. Yeah, and maybe getting scared a little bit.
It's always good to be scared quite a bit. Yeah. Well, so thank you very much. A special thanks to Julien for sharing his story with us. Well, a part of it. And we wish you all the best on your future endeavors. And thanks to everyone for listening. And on behalf of the Arcteryx Climbing Academy, I wish you all the best. All of the interview and the content will be able on the platform, so stay up to that. And go on the website of the Arcteryx Climbing Academy to find more about Julien and this interview. So thank you very much, and see you soon, probably.
Yeah, see you at the crowd.
Bye.
Ciao.